believed in science, and there were major scientists in the past. There was a man named Aristotle, and if you went to school, maybe you studied about the triangle, the Aristotle calculations. He was good in math and numerous things. And he established a principle, and he said, if you go to a high place and you drop, let's say, a weight of 1 ton and another one with 1 pound, and he said the one that weighs a ton will fall faster than the one that weighs a pound. And so this was accepted science. So all scientists accepted this for 2,000 years. Till there was a man named Galileo. And Galileo went to a place in Italy called Pisa. Not pizza, but Pisa, with P-I-S-A. And happens that in that place there's this very interesting tower, which is leaning. And it's a leaning tower at Pisa. It's very famous. I've been there. It's an awesome place. If you can go to Italy, don't lose this opportunity. And Galileo did some other calculations. And so he decided to prove that it doesn't matter the weight of an object, if it's a ton or a pound, it will fall at the same speed. So he tried to prove that the famous Aristotle was wrong. And that in fact, if you drop a ton or 10 tons and a pound, the speed of the drop, it's exactly the same. So he got a bunch of professors and scientists at the time, and they all went there, and he went to the top of the tower, and he had a small weight and a cannonball and all this. And so he proved that it doesn't matter the weight of an object, it will fall at the same speed. So he established the laws of gravity. And you know what? The scientists were there. They've seen it, but they still couldn't accept it. So it took many, many years so people will accept Galileo. Galileo was a very controversial man. Even the church, Roman Catholic Church, didn't like him. Because he said that it was not the sun going around the earth, but it was actually the opposite. The earth was revolving around the sun. So this provoked quite a change. And today I would like to play the role of Galileo in terms of church. We maybe have these preconceived ideas. And I would like you to, you know, think out of the box, all right? And in order to do so, I'd like to read from the book of Revelation. Revelation, it's the last book of the Bible, very easy to find. And the book starts by saying, Revelation of Jesus Christ. So this is what the book is all about. So if anyone tells Revelations, plural, it's wrong. This is not Revelations. This is the Revelation of Jesus Christ. So this is the big revelation of Jesus Christ. Somebody once told me they know the Bible from Genesis to Revelations. And so it's not that name, it's Revelation. So in the first chapter, chapter 1, and I'd like to read to you, verse 4, John starts by bringing the revelation to the church. So this is a revelation still to us. And he says, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness. It's over there. The faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Verse 5, 6. And he has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So, let's try to understand this scripture and what it means to us, because if we truly understand this, we'll be happier as Christians, and we will know what we should do here on earth while we expect the coming of our Lord. But notice the previous verse, verse 5, it says on the bottom, over there on the slide, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. So the condition to be in the category here of verse 6 that you see there, he made us kings and priests, you need to be washed in his blood. So he washed us in his precious blood. And this happens in the spirit. When you surrender your life to Jesus, when you accept Jesus as Lord and King, automatically there's something that happens in the spirit. You washed in the blood, and since you washed in the blood, now you receive a privilege. Now you're a child of God. And as a child of God, the book of Revelation says that you were made kings and priests. I know some translations will say kingdom, but let's stick to the King James today, where it says kings and priests. So, the first thing I want to mention is that He has made us. He has made us. So, He has already made us. What? Kings and priests. Is that clear to all of us? So, He has made us kings and priests. Now, what does this mean? It means that now, when I greet Pastor Victor, I'll say, Howdy, Priest Victor. No, it's not a matter of titles, but it's who we are in this world, who we are in the Spirit. And my first point is that everything that God makes, He does it well. Alright? So, we have good kings and bad kings. And we have good priests and we have bad priests. Right? Have you ever met a bad priest? I've been a few. And bad kings, bad priests. However, because we were made by Him, we are the good ones. Amen? So we're not the bad kings and the bad priests, we are the good ones. Because He has made us. We didn't make ourselves, He has made us. You see, there's a difference. Now, we were created and made in His image. And today, Jesus Christ is in heaven. And He's right there as a high priest. This is written in the book of Hebrews. I'm not sure if I put the reference in the slides. I think I did. But the Bible says that He's our high priest. You know, when He was ministering as a human being here on earth, He was called a prophet. Right? So He's a prophet. Who are you? He's a prophet. A prophet. He was more than a prophet, but He was seen as a prophet. That's how He came. And when He entered Jerusalem, guess what the people want to make Him? They want to make Him a king. So they said, come and be our king. And He was riding a donkey, and He was fulfilling the prophecy. See, Jerusalem, your king, is riding on a donkey, coming into Jerusalem. And they were just cheering and applauding, saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, to the Son of David. Because now they thought there's going to be someone to succeed in the throne of Israel that comes from the bloodline of David. He is the Son of David. So they wanted to do Him king. And this happened several times. If you read the Gospels, especially the Gospel of John, mentions several occasions in which people were just in awe, and there was this crowd following Jesus, and they said, let's get rid of King Herod and let's make Jesus our king. That didn't happen. He didn't allow me. He ran to desert places and said, no, I don't want to be a king. Why? Because it wasn't His time to be a king. He came as a prophet. Now today, right now, He's in heaven as our high priest. But you know what? The Bible says He's going to return. And when He returns, anyone wants to try to guess what will be His category? Priest? King? King of Kings. So He will return as King. And the book of Revelation reveals Jesus Christ now as a high priest, but He's the King of Kings. And there's this description of Jesus riding a white horse and coming, and all the armies of heaven, and everybody's, it's epic. It's better than one of those Hollywood movies. You know, you see those Hollywood movies, they always have the figure, of the Savior that comes with the armies. They come, and then there's the armies of the enemy, and there's a big battle, and they, you know, in all cultures, even the pop culture, we have this image of the Savior. Though Jesus Christ is the true Savior, He's our Savior. Amen? So He came as a prophet. Now that category for Him is over. He will not come as a prophet anymore. So he's in heaven as our high priest, and he will return as the king. Book of Psalms says, open up the gates, the King of Glory is coming. You see that song here, open up the gates. and we were expecting this to happen. Now, what about us? What does this have to do with us? It's very important to understand this. I'm not talking about prophetic ministry, of course. We have prophets today, and we have all these things. But he has made us kings and priests. And as soon as I started to study the Bible and I see this, I realized that this must be something special. Let me just give you this example. If now I had a basketball here, I could play basketball, and I'm not terrible playing basketball, but I'm not that good. It's not my height, not to do with my height. I was more like a soccer player. But give me a basketball, and I'll try, you know, to throw it to the net, and I'm not that bad. But put that same ball in the hands of Michael Jordan, and now you'll be in awe with what he can do with that ball. I know I will not be able to take the ball out of his hand. Probably after 2 hours annoying him, I will be able. But, you know, the ball is the same ball. So if I'm playing with that ball, I can do a number of things. However, if it's in the hands of the master, wow, we have the wow factor. We say, what an amazing player. What an amazing dribble. What an amazing play. Oh, that's really something. It's amazing. Same thing with a brush, you know. I can paint. I'm not that bad. But if you put the same brush in the hands of, you know, a famous painter, of an artist, that will make a difference. Even those guys that are in the street, you know, just doing drawings for 20 bucks, most of them are better than me. And maybe you, I don't know. But sometimes, if you ever stop and you see these guys, you know, doing drawings and all these things. And we need to understand, when something is in the right hands, in the hands of the master, it will fulfill its purpose. Amen? So, in order to understand this of being kings and priests, first thing we need to understand, you need to be in the hands of the master. We're in God, when you're in God's hands, he will do amazing things through you. You just have to say, yes, Lord, I'm here, I'm in your hands. And then accept who you are. Don't try to be something that you're not called to be. Now, who are the kings and who are the priests? We all have duties. And one of the things that I failed to understand when I became a Christian was my role in God's kingdom, in the church. So I wanted to help the church, and I tried to do a number of things. I played the guitar, I gave testimonies, I cleaned the washrooms, all these things. And I was happy, I liked to come to church, but I always said, God, I'll do anything for you but being a pastor. That I don't want. I hate speaking in public, I don't like to be under a spotlight, you know, I don't speak very well, all these things. And if you have ever had a microphone and you don't like to be at the front, you know what I mean. And so I will always say, God, anything but pastor. So God had to work some process in my life till I got to the point where I said, anything, God, anything. And since then I've learned that when we walk with the Lord, we have different purposes. So for a season I worked drug rehab, then for another season I worked as an evangelist, I helped pastors, then I planted churches, and that's what I did the most. I planted churches, I became a senior pastor, I was here with you, it was such a privilege to be a pastor here in this church. You know, it's nice, I still miss it so much. But then in a new purpose, I became more kind of a church administrator. Now I'm a senior pastor again. And now, don't you bother that I'm doing all this stuff and she's there sitting down. And we see that there was a difference between Martha and Mary. Martha enjoyed doing stuff. In this sense, Martha was a king. She enjoyed, just achieving things, doing things, conquering the prize of master chef in that house. She was in the kitchen. And Mary was more like a priest. She wanted to listen to Jesus and, speak, "Lord, and I will listen." She was so spiritual. And you see, in the same house, two sisters, one was a king, another one was a priest, in the sense that kings conquer, kings do things, kings bring provision, kings do protection, they do practical stuff, and priests minister to the Lord, take care of people, pray, praise the Lord. And in a church like Carisma Church, in any church, we have people that are kings and we have people that are priests. And we have some that want to do all things, and that's not going to work. Because you need to understand who you are. If you're a king, you should try to do the work of a priest, and vice versa. Are we on the same page? Are you following me? Okay, so here in Revelation chapter 5, verse 9, it says, "And they sang a new song, saying, You are worthy to take the scroll and open..." Oh, I need to read from there. "And open these seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. And have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign over all the earth." So here's a new song they're singing in heaven. I don't know the beat. I don't know if this is rock, if it's contemporary worship. I don't know what is, but I know the lyrics. And the lyrics, part of the lyrics says that we're so glad and we're worshiping you because you have made us what? Guess what? Kings and priests. So this is something we need to understand. So kings bring dominion, provision, and priests, they're more into glory and vision and all spiritual things. So if we understand who we are in Christ, we should accept one another. And let's say we have a party and we were setting up tables and all this work, and some of you are working and putting the chairs and the tablecloths and all these things, and there's someone that comes and says, "I'm going to the church and pray." And you say, "You going to the church and pray and I'm here doing all this work?" I know this stuff doesn't happen here anymore, just when I was a pastor here. You know what I mean? And sometimes we don't accept that we are different, and some like to do practical things, and then the ones that pray will come here and you have a night of worship and prayer, and it's 6 a.m. and the small group is here praising the Lord. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! And then you see your king sister and you say, "Oh, we stay praying until 6 a.m. And she'll say, "6 a.m.? These people are nuts. I cannot pray for more than 5 minutes, 50 minutes, the whole night. These people are crazy. Are you a fanatic or something? What's wrong with you?" Are you following me? There's nothing wrong. Some people are more into ministering to the Lord, and some people are more into doing practical things. Some, they just worship the Lord and they're rich in the Spirit. And some are able to bring a $14,000 offering because they're kings. And that's what kings do. Kings bring provision. I'm not saying that you only do one of these things, but there are seasons in our life which we are more like kings, and others we are more like priests. And I had a hard time to understand this. I'm in a season now that I'm more of a priest. The season I had before, I was more of a king. I was doing things, practical things and organization, setting up computers and doing websites for churches and all these things. So it's more like the work of a king. Now I'm more doing the work of a priest. So, and in your life, it doesn't mean that you will always be like this. You will always do what you're called to do. It might it's a process and there's changes. Think about David. David was a shepherd, and he loved and enjoyed playing the harp. And after he defeated Goliath, he was in the palace. There was one king, King Saul, and he was there
functioning more as a priest, because King Saul gave room to evil, and he felt bad, and he only had comfort when David praised the Lord. So David will go there and he will praise the Lord. I bless the Lord, bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is in within me, sing. And Saul was just, continue, David, continue singing. He was more of a priest. But later in his life, you know, he was anointed king, but he wasn't operating as a king. Later in his life, he became the king. And when he became the king, he tried to do the work of the priest, and it didn't work. And I don't want to spend too much time in this message, but I want just to show you this, because when a king wants to be a priest, or the opposite, we have problems. And today, kings are more like, you know, businessmen, marketplace people, and priests are the ministers. And when I say ministers, it's not just the pastors and people that work for the church. Many of you here, you're priests. And that's your call. You like to pray for others. And in this passage in 1 Chronicles, I'm not going to read the whole passage, but David tried to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. And so he gathered the musicians and he said, oh, we're going to do a celebration. They found the Ark of the Covenant, and they built the chariot, and they had some animals, I think. You know, they're pulling the Ark. And as they're doing this with musical instruments, they're ministering into the Lord. Here's the king organizing the worship service. And what happened is that when they got to a certain place, the chariot just tilted, and then a man named Uzzah tried to hold the Ark, and he died right there. And that was disgraceful. Imagine that you're here, you're having a worship service, it's a great celebration, and somebody touches the glory of God and dies. Oh, that's terrible, isn't it? So David was so upset. And after this happened, and I'm not going to elaborate more on the story, but it says that David was so upset in the situation that the service was over and the Ark stayed there. And he said, no, I'm not going to take the Ark to Jerusalem. Here's the king trying to do the work of a priest. Then he found out that the man that received the Ark was being so blessed, and he said, man, I have to have that Ark. I want to have that, you know, the blessing of the Ark. How come the Ark is now there hiding? I want that blessing. I mean, it's better than a lucky penny. It's something that you have, that, you know, an object. Imagine that there's an object. If you have that object, everything you touch turns into gold. You want that object? So you see how King David is thinking? And he built wealth. Oh, if he built wealth. And what happened is that then he realized how to transport the Ark. And he finally decided to bring it the right way. Priests bringing the Ark. And then he prospered. And the Bible says, notice there, David built houses for himself. And houses is palaces. You know, bigger than the ones in Ancaster or Dundas. And, you know, the big, big mansions were David's. And what did he build for the Lord? See what's there. He pitched a tent for the Ark. You know, yesterday we were just celebrating in Pastor Victor's house. You know, it was awesome to be there. And they had this small tent. I think I said small, so people won't go there to try to see it. But they pitched the tent outside. Not for the Ark. But they pitched the tent. And I was saying, no, this is awesome to do church services, you know. But a tent is a temporary thing. You don't pitch a tent in order to live there. Hello? In fact, I was joking with him because he has this camping thing. And I was telling him, you should rent that, you know, $500 a month. Put a porta potty there and you can rent this. I was just joking. You don't pitch a tent to live in a tent. But David had no problem with this. Why? He was a king. Can you imagine the priests, what they were saying? So King David
builds a palace for himself. And look at this, the glory of God, the ark is in a tent.
Well, in fact, he then wanted to build the temple. He was not allowed, because he was not the right person to do this job. So Solomon built the temple. I don't want to elaborate more on this, because I would like to finish this message, and I'm just going to skip a few verses. And let me go to my last point before we pray, vision and provision. Okay? As a church, there's vision. And for instance, the vision is we want people, I don't know how many people drive here every day on Main Street, but let's say 20,000 people at least, or 50,000. Maybe 50,000, I don't know, 20,000, 50,000 people that drive here every day. Between 20 and 50, I believe 20 to 50,000 people drive every day here by the church door. So there's a vision. How can we cause people to look at the church? And then you have the priest, the visionary. We're going to put the flashing sign, putting the temperature. It's going to be digital. And it's going to be awesome. And when people drive by, they want to see the temperature and the time. And each time those 20,000 people drive by, they're going to see that there's a church here. That's a good idea. That's vision. Now, how are we going to do it? We need what? We need money, we need funds. So then we need provision. In fact, it's what this word is. Now, if there's abundance, let's enjoy the abundance. I wish I had more abundance. I don't. I always pray for abundance. But I'm happy with what I am. I know how to be happy with in times of luck, in times of blessing. Do you know that also? Amen. So then in the church we have kings and priests. If we just have priests, it's horrible. Listen, churches in which everybody is so spiritual, and there's money for nothing, and you enter that church and it's trash everywhere, and it's old, and the sound is like a cheap radio, and you know everything's bad, and the sign is tearing apart, and all these things. Picking up on you guys. But you know what I mean? So we need to have people that pray, but we need to have also people that are faithful to the Lord and bring their tithes and offerings. And when you bring your tithes and offerings and you're faithful, guess what happens? God opens the floodgates of heaven, and it's a flow, and your business is always prospering, and it prospers every time more, and you sow that into the kingdom, and God gives you even more, and then you learn that there is a principle, wherever you sow, you reap, and then suddenly the house has the two things, the kings and the priests.